Wow. Today's plenary is called AIDS and the Responsibility of the Writer. Panelists are Sarah Schulman, Essex Hemphill, Pat Califia, Susan Griffin, and John Preston. I'll be doing introductions to each of these writers as we progress. We've all been had the experience of being affected by AIDS. I was a caretaker for a neighbor, friend of mine, my name was Jack Stellman, and I remember going to the hospital a lot. And once in a conversation, he said to me after he was kind of gone off drugs and was just waiting, he said to me, "My language is leaving the bank." We kind of laughed and went, "Well, where did that stuff come from?" But those words have really haunted me because we are losing too many writers. And our language is being affected by this loss. Our language is a loss of, it's about loss, it's about greed, it's about militancy. Our language is also being censored. These writers here write in relationship to AIDS. With those words, we'll let them speak for themselves. Let me go down, take this opportunity to kind of introduce the panelists from afar. It's John Preston, Pat Califia, Essex Hemphill, Sarah Schulman, and Susan Griffin. I forgot to introduce myself. I'm Roberto, our first speaker is Sarah Schulman, and she's the author of numerous books, the Sophie Horowitz story, Girls, Vision, and Everything, After Dolores, which was the winner of the American Library Association's Gay and Lesbian Book Award. Her new book is called People in Trouble, which just been released on Spinality. The book starts for about a month. That also is being adapted for the stage by the Houston Grand Opera. She writes regularly on AIDS and other issues for publications like The Village Voice, The New York Times, The Nation magazine. She is also a member of ACT UP in New York. Sarah Schulman.
First, I want to talk about writing, and then I want to talk about responsibility. I just published a novel, People in Trouble, about the AIDS crisis. I spent 3 years working on it, and in the process, confronted a lot of questions particular to AIDS fiction. When I began working, there were very few books about AIDS. They were mostly about facing one's own illness or the death of a lover. I knew that I was not writing from either of these perspectives, and so identified for myself the category of witness fiction, so that I could understand the position of my words in this event. To be writing about something of this enormity when it surrounds you leaves those of us who write about AIDS no possibility of objectivity. Nor can there be any conclusiveness, since the crisis and our responses to it change rapidly and daily. And so I knew that I was committing to ideas and impressions that would already be history by the time the book actually reached readers. For example, in People in Trouble, I imagined a small demonstration by AIDS activists at St. Patrick's Cathedral in New York City. 2.5 years ago, I imagined 40 nervous men cautiously standing up to disrupt the religious service. Of 7,000 angry men and women confronting the cathedral. In this case, the community I was writing for and about made the boundaries of my imagination obsolete. There is no existing vocabulary for discussing AIDS. To expect one would be unreasonable, since this is an event that we will be spending generations trying to understand and define. But In order to discuss it in novel form, I needed to identify a series of words or images that would be generally resonant. This is a challenging task in a culture that does not acknowledge truth and a community that is emotionally overwhelmed. I started out by making lists of hundreds of details pertaining to the crisis. Rock Hudson at the airport being whisked off to Paris, watch alarms going off in public places, men with teddy bears, friends spreading AL-721 on their toast in the morning, people spending their life savings on Ampligen or dextrin sulfate, finding out later that those drugs were worthless. Then I chose 50 that I felt would be meaningful symbols to large groups of people, symbols that might have lasting resonance. This was an attempt to identify vocabulary while understanding that to establish this vocabulary, this group of words, is perhaps all the first generation of AIDS writers can do, in the hope that future writers will use this foundation to evolve a more comprehensive and challenging literature. I also had to reject words, words that were being used to distort, words that were lies, words like general population,
yes.
Words like innocent victim.
Yes.
I also had to challenge my own earlier vocabulary. When I began writing about AIDS, I used the word Holocaust. Now I've changed my thinking. The Yiddish word for Holocaust is korban, which means wreck, like a shipwreck. It implies violence, disarray, and chaos, but not annihilation. AIDS is not a Holocaust, because for all our pain, we are not annihilated. I also made a decision for myself personally that I was not writing a novel documenting the life and death of a single individual, but that instead I wanted to use the examples of people's lives to discuss a precise political idea, namely, how personal homophobia becomes societal neglect, that there is a direct relationship between the two, and that this nation needs to confront this configuration in order to adequately address this crisis. In the past, I've written novels about the interior lives of marginal communities, and this enabled me to have some approval from the straight press because they could read my work voyeuristically. This time I knew I wanted to be accusatory to straight people, to bring them into the literature in a manner equal to the role they play in this crisis, one of apathy, neglect, and denial. For that reason, I had to write a primary character who is a straight man. That's when I discovered that, just as literature has distorted women into the virgin-whore dichotomy, straight men have been distorted into the hero-villain dichotomy, neither of which I find generally appropriate. So when I committed to violating these conventions by describing someone unaware of how other people are living, and unaware of how much power he wields, I found myself vulnerable to being dismissed with, "Oh, she's a lesbian, she hates men." There does not yet exist a way for lesbian and gay writers to address the straight male character and their societal power without being subjected to this dismissal. The fact remains that marginal people know how they live, and they know how the dominant culture lives. Dominant culture people only know how they live. So the people with the most power have the least information. To state this is still considered didactic or extreme. I had more surprises when I began touring with the book, since, except in San Francisco, men do not generally come to my readings, or to readings of lesbian writers in general, and audiences are mostly women. When I went to cities where AIDS is not as much in people's daily lives as it is for us in San Francisco and New York, I found that people no longer want to talk about writing or books, but instead they want to talk about AIDS, to the point of asking me information about transmission, as well as expressing various levels of discomfort with regards to the politics of AIDS activism. One question that came up over and over again is, don't you think that if the shoe was on the other foot, and this was happening to lesbians, that the guys wouldn't help us? And of course I have to answer yes. But at the same time, not give in to the homophobic stereotype that gay men hate women, and assert instead that this lack of reciprocity exists because they're men, not because they're gay men. Straight men don't do anything to help straight men be great men on the marriage. That male experience is the objective neutral experience, and all other experiences can be generalized from it. This is why we see so little awareness or advocacy by gay men on women's behalf, not only with regard to AIDS, but with regard to cancer, sexual assault, economic oppression, and abortion. However, I know at the same time that gay men have been allowed to die because they are gay, not because they are men. And I also know from 2 years of involvement with ACT UP New York that there is a general understanding in that organization that sexism is not only wrong, it is politically inefficient. Additionally, on a human level, the fact of the gay community going co-ed is something that is where women earn half of what men earn, to move from a movement of all women to a movement of men. I guess it's something akin to experiencing heterosexual privilege for the first time. We now have access to money, power, visibility, and resources that men move with in this culture. And I hope we can use these resources to benefit all of us.
Essex Hemphill. He is a poet, performance artist, and editor. His books and poems are Earth Life and Conditions. He's been involved with these critically acclaimed films called Looking for Langston and Tongues Untied. He's editing the
forthcoming anthology called Brothers to Brother, Essex Hemphill.
I'm going to swerve around these issues of age and responsibility a little bit and share with you a brief excerpt from Brother to Brother from the introduction, which will, I think, dovetail in and out of the commentary from all the panelists. Throughout the 1980s, many of us grieved the loss of friends, lovers, and relatives who were one moment strong, healthy, and able-bodied. But then in an instant, they became thin-framed, hacking and wheezing, their bodies racked with horrible pain. Sometimes, brave souls would return to the family roost to disclose their sexuality and ask permission to die in familiar surroundings. Too often, families were discovering for the first time that the dear brother, the favorite uncle, the secretive son, was a homosexual, a black gay man, and the unfortunate victim of the killer virus, AIDS. Some parents had always known, and others had never suspected, that their son was a black gay man, a sissy, a queer, a faggot. For some families, this shock of recognition and grief expressed itself as shame and anger. It compels them to disown their flesh and blood, denying dying men the love and support their friends often provided as extended family. In other instances, families were very understanding and bravely stood by their brethren through his final days. The late Joseph Bean, editor of In the Life, in his powerful essay, Brother to Brother, Words from the Heart, defined home as being larger, more complex, and encompassing than one's living room. He said, when I speak of home, I mean not only the familial constellation from which I grew, but the entire black community, the black press, the black church, black academicians, the black literati, and the black left. Where is my reflection? I am most often rendered invisible, perceived as a threat to the family, or I am tolerated if I am silent and inconspicuous. I cannot go home as who I am, and that hurts me deeply. Joe articulated one of the primary contradictions black gay men face when our relationships to our families and communities are closely examined. We cannot afford to be disconnected from these institutions, yet we seem willing to create and accept dysfunctional roles in these spaces, roles of caricature and illusion, which allow us to engage in dishonest relationships with our kin and fosters an apathetic relationship between us and the communities of home that we need and that are in need of our presence. The contradiction of home is additionally amplified when black gay men's relationships with the white gay community are also examined. The white gay community of the 1980s was not seriously concerned with the plight of black men except as sexual objects. The black male was given very little representation except most often as a big black dick. This aspect of white gay consciousness is best revealed by the photographs of the late Robert Mapplethorpe on the subject of black males. Though his images may be technically and aesthetically well composed, what occurs in his work often enough to be of concern is his ability artistically to perpetuate racial stereotypes constructed around sexuality. In some of his images, we are only shown parts of the anatomy, genitals, chest, buttocks, close up and close cropped to elicit desire. Mapplethorpe's eye pays special attention to the penis at the expense of showing us the subject's face and thus a whole person. The penis becomes the identity of the black male, which is the classic stereotype recreated and presented as art in the context of a gay vision. Mapplethorpe's man in a polyester suit, for example, presents a black man without a head, wearing a business suit, his trousers unzipped, and his fat, long penis dangling down, a penis that is not erect. It can be assumed that many viewers appreciative of Mapplethorpe's work and those constructing sexual fantasies from it probably wondered first, how much larger would that penis become during erection, as opposed to wondering, who is the man in the photo, or why is his head missing? What is insulting and endangering to black men on one level is Mapplethorpe's conscious determination that the faces, the heads, and by extension, the minds and experiences of some of his black subjects were not as important as close-up shots of their penises. It is virtually impossible to view Mapplethorpe's photos of black males and avoid confronting issues of exploitation and objectification. Additionally, black gay men are not immune to the desire elicited by these photos. In True Confessions, a discourse on images of black male sexuality, Isaac Julian and Cobino Mercer accurately identify this dichotomy when they observe that Mapplethorpe's images of black males reiterate the terms of colonial fantasy and service the expectations of white desire. But what do these images say to our wants and desires as black gay men, they ask. When black gay men approach the gay community to participate in the struggle for acceptance and to forge bonds of brotherhood, bonds so loftily proclaimed to be the vision of the best gay minds of my generation, we discovered that the beautiful rhetoric was empty. The disparity between words and action was as wide as the Atlantic Ocean and deeper than Dante's hell. There was no gay community for black men to come home to in the 1980s. What was there was as mythical and distant from the realities of black men as was Oz and its relationship to Kansas. At the baths, certain bars and bookstores and cruising zones, black men were welcome. These constructions of pleasure allowed the races to mutually explore sexual fantasies. And, after all, the black man engaging in such a construction only needed to whip out a penis of almost any size to obtain the rapt attention withheld from him and other social political structures. These sites of pleasure were more tolerable of the presence of black men because they enhanced the sexual ambiance. But that same tolerance did not always apply once the sun began to rise. Open fraternizing at a level suggesting companionship or love between the races was not tolerated in the light of day by many black men or white gay men. Terms such as Dinge Queen, which refers to white men who prefer black men, and Snow Queen, which refers to black men who prefer white men, were created by a gay community that could obviously not be trusted to believe its own rhetoric concerning brotherhood, fellowship, and dignity. Silence, complicity, and racial apathy is capable of reinforcing these conditions. Some of the best gay minds of my generation would have us believe AIDS has brought the gay community closer together and infused it with a more democratic mandate. That is only a partial truth, which further underscores the fact that the gay community still operates from a one-eyed, one-color perception of community that is most likely to recognize blonde before black, but seldom the two together. Some of the best minds of my generation believe AIDS has made the gay community a more responsible construction. But what AIDS really manages to do is clearly point out how significant are the cultural and economic differences between us. Differences so extreme that black men suffer a disproportionate number of AIDS deaths in communities with very sophisticated gay healthcare services. Some of the best gay minds of my generation believe that we speak as one voice and dream one dream, but we are not monolithic. We are not even respectful of each other's differences. We are communities engaged in a fragile coexistence if we are anything at all. Our most significant coalitions have been created in the realm of sex. What is most clear for black gay men is this: we have to do more for ourselves now and for each other now what no one has ever done for us. We have to be there for one another and trust less in the adhesions of semen and kisses to bind us. The only sure guarantee we have of survival is that which we construct from our own self-determination. Look around, my brothers. There is rampant killing occurring in our communities. Drug addiction and drug trafficking overwhelm us. The blood of young black males runs curbside in a steady flow. The bodies of black infants crave crack, not the warmth called mother's love. The nation's prisons are reservations and shelters for black men. An entire generation of black youths is self-destructing before our eyes. We cannot witness this in silence and apathy and claim our hands are bloodless. We are a wandering tribe that needs to go home before home is gone. We need not continue standing in line to be admitted into spaces that don't want us there sometimes. We cannot continue to exist without clinics and businesses, human services, and cultural institutions that we create to support, sustain, and affirm us. Our mothers and fathers are waiting for us. Our sisters and brothers are waiting. Our communities are waiting for us to come home. They need our love, our talents and skills, and we need theirs. They may not understand everything about us, but they will remain ignorant, misinformed, and lonely for us, and we for them, for as long as we stay away, hiding in communities that have never really welcomed us or the gifts we bring. I ask you, brothers, does your mama really know about you? Does she really know what I am? Does she know I want to love her son and care for him, nurture and celebrate him? Do you think she'll understand? I hope so, because I am coming home. There is no place else to go that will be worth so much effort and love. Thank you.
Social justice and economy. ecology. That is the way that we treat each other as human beings and the way that we are in nature. It has come to be obvious to me in the last years that there's a very deep connection between the issue of compassion and the issue of our connection to nature. And that as we sever our connection to nature, we also sever our compassion towards each other. I want to talk to you a little bit about my process of discovering something, my process of discovering what I'm going to talk to you about today. I've been working on a book on nuclear war for the past 6 years, and my seventh year working on it now. And I became very moved and riveted by the issue of people who've been exposed to low-level radiation. I started to attend meetings of the National Association of Radiation Survivors and hear their stories. And I was moved by this phrase, witness fiction, that Sarah Schulman used, because it seemed to me very important to bear witness to this that was going on. And that's another area that's denied very severely in this culture, the fact that people are suffering terribly who've been exposed to radiation. But what is also denied, what I came to understand myself personally after a few years working with this, is that we're all exposed to low-level radiation. There are many of us who are becoming ill from this. I have an illness that is called chronic fatigue immune dysfunctional syndrome. It's now one of the illnesses that's included in ACT-UP's program along with HIV and R. It's an immune disorder. It's an immunological disorder that strikes 4/5 women. But men also, there's 1/5 of people that are men. Gordy Dahl has it also. It has been characterized in the press as yummy disease. It's been falsely connected to depression. They tried to psychologize it out of existence, but in fact, laboratory work shows damage to the T cells and natural killer cells, and it is a very severely disabling disease that can even, at times, cause death. I came to understand that, in fact, radiation affects the immune system directly. The way that we're introduced to radiation is affected usually through the indication of cancer. Cancer is used statistically to epidemiologically study the effect of radiation. But in fact, what radiation does is it affects the immune system, and then any disease which is related to the immune system, which includes cancer, anything you can name, diabetes, lupus, arthritis, all of these diseases go up, the incidence of them go up when the immune system is affected. There's Rosalie Bertel and Alice Stewart, two scientists who've done very extensive epidemiological studies of the low-level effects of radiation, which shows a higher incidence of these diseases during the periods when there have been more atmospheric testing and also downwind of atmospheric testing, or in the area where there's radiation risk buried or cell field in England. I think that one of the effects of looking at AIDS as like a gay disease and looking at syphilis as a woman's disease, and then conflating the two of them with the scapegoating that we as gay people and we as women experience, is that it then separates the disease process away from the rest of the population. People can say, well, this is not going to happen to me. It's not happening to me. I'm safe from this. And in fact, the result of this is that at this point, we're not seeing a very clear pattern. And we're blind to what's actually going on. It's a very, very profound level of denial, which is that, in fact, the human immune system is being affected now. And that one of the extremely important elements of the disease process of both AIDS and SIFFIDS and a number of other immunological disorders that, that have either newly arisen or have risen in their incidence is the environment. Radiation and then radiation combined with other ecological contaminants. We're living in an atmosphere that has never existed before on the face of the earth. It's been profoundly altered. And the human organism, which took billions of years to grow, has not changed in relation to the way that we've changed the environment. It's not only trees that are suffering, but we as human beings are beginning to show the effects of ecological disaster. There's not a single major government-funded study that's looking at the relationship between ecological contamination and AIDS or SIFFIDS or any of the immunological disorders. By the way, there are also serious immunological disorders shown by the animals and the whales in the St. Lawrence Seaway. I don't know if you read about the seals. I had a major attack of SIFFIDS when I was in Germany, and there were headlines all over about seals dying in the North Sea of an immunological disease. Camus begins the play with a description that I want to read to you. It's a description of Iran, and it's a town that is suddenly beset by the plague. And he opens the novel by describing the town. The town itself, let us admit, is ugly. It has a smug, placid air, and you need time to discover what it is that makes it different from so many business centers in other parts of the world. How to conjure up a picture, for instance, of a town without pigeons, without any trees or gardens, where you never hear the beat of wings or the rustle of leaves, a thoroughly negative place, in short. The seasons are discriminated only in the sky. All that tells you spring's coming is the feel of the air, where the baskets of flowers were brought in from the suburbs by peddlers. It's a spring pride in the marketplaces. And he speaks of the life in this town as being devoid of any life except work life and the energy, the effort of earning money. And he says about this town, and it's a very, very bad place to die, because nobody's very interested when you're dying, nobody's present, and nobody's present to the actual experience of dying. It's a very isolated, atomized community. And the town is also beset by racism. There's a pervasive pattern of prejudice towards the Arabs who live in the town. And all of these attitudes, all of these issues come together to make the town unable to deal in any effective way with the plague when it comes to the town. In fact, the plague spreads much more rapidly and people die because the town is ill already. It has a very profound illness, and this is this lack of compassion and lack of connectedness between human beings. And I think that that's what we're dealing with in this culture today. The cruelty that is implicit in an attitude that conflates the disease with the behavior of the person who is ill is really something that I think we need to get inside and understand. It's quite something to be on the other end of that kind of attitude. I'm speaking, for instance, of the idea that AIDS is caused by a sexual practice. Or the idea that SIFFIDS is, that there's been a theory to try to say that SIFFIDS is caused by a depression in women, and depression links somehow to women working too hard. It's just that old idea that if we go to college, we'll injure our ovaries. I think that where such cruelty exists, it really comes back to injure the society itself. For one thing, very crucially, those of us who are ill are the canaries in the mine. If you don't know what that metaphor means, in fact, there was a practice in the earlier days of mining in which they took canaries in a cage down into the mines, and if the canaries died, they knew that the mines were not safe for the miners because they were noxious fumes. Those of us who are ill are the ones who are the first to signal the effects of a planet which is ill and a society which is ill. I feel that as writers, it's extremely important for us to attend to this experience directly in all its shapes and forms, to be able to listen to and give voice to the direct physical experience, the emotional experience. It's a profound experience, the experience of illness, the experience of losing someone you love, the experience of death. And that that along with all of our other protests, that it's very important for us to cherish and hold on to the significance and the meaning in those actual experiences and not let them be stolen from us or redefined or disconnected from us. I want to end with a speech from this play that I'm in the midst of working on called 1, 2, 3 Loss. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. I'm counting the loose threads. Four means everything's all right. And 3. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. 3 means bad luck. 1, 2, 3, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 3, 4. Things don't always come out the way you want. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. Going down underneath into the midst of it. I didn't turn back. I fell into that place myself. 1, 2. 1, 2, 3, 4, 3, 4, I recovered, fell ill again, recovered again, fell ill again, recovered, fell, recovered, fell, recovered, 1, 2, 3, 4, fell, 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 it is me now at the edge, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, it isn't the way it's supposed to be, 1, 2, 3, when I stand, I don't know how strong my legs will be, 1, 2, 3, loss, I don't know if I can get across, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, beginning, a sentence, beginning, a sentence, I don't know, I do not know what the words will be.
Was the letterman, who's the author of Urban Legends. Robert McQueen, a former editor of The Advocate, who used to call himself in his Grammy moments Rim McQueen, and Cynthia Slater, who's an ex-lover of mine, who was one of the founders of the Bay Area's SM community, and in some ways a living man in Outwrite. None of these people were sexual moderates. And sometimes they were real jerks about it. No, they were capable of being cruel and selfish and stupid about their quest for pleasure. But they were willing to go into shadowy places to seek intense and very intimate experiences, even if those experiences were with strangers. And what they gave me was a real treasury of goodness, an honor for the human body, an ability to be honest about all of my desires, even if I think it's not wise to act on all of my desires. And none of them were writers. None of them were writers, and the world that they lived in, the world in which they were sexual outlaws, is gone. So if it's going to survive, it survives in me, and people like me, and our work. I publish both fiction and nonfiction, and a lot of the fiction that I write and most of what I publish is pornography. And that may be because, in terms of my life, I can't tell a reader who I'm having breakfast with every day without telling them stuff that they don't want to hear because of the nature of the relationship. And to survive, my strategy has been that if people are going to tell me my life is unspeakable, I will speak about it. Yes. If they tell me that it's horrible, I will frighten them. And if they tell me that I am garbage, I will make them eat every bite. The fact that I am, as Dorothy Allison has coined the phrase, a queer sort of queer, means that I am isolated not only by virtue of my homosexuality, but also isolated within the gay community. Now, that doesn't mean I feel sorry for myself. I like my life. I like being this bad girl. But it does mean that in these times, which are getting progressively more conservative, where there's more censorship from the state, I'm progressively more concerned about censorship within our own community. Okay? Because the bookstores that won't carry my work for damn sure are not going to hold my benefit to contribute to my defense fund. So, I also do, in addition to writing fiction, a lot of sex education, mostly in the Advocate Advisor column, where I'm in the odd position of being a dyke who's telling faggots how to have sex. Gender dysphoria has its advantages. Is not working. It is not happening. And even inside major cities where we have done intense grassroots education about how to have safer sex, people are looking for any excuse not to do it. You will not believe the letters I get. Well, you would, because somebody wrote them. Condoms don't fit me. Then I have to say. And that's true. People are afraid of them breaking, so they persuade themselves that condoms are not effective anyway, so why use them in the first place? Now, the most common strategy people employ is to find a lover. They both get tested. They're both HIV negative, so they figure they can do anything with each other. Should we ask for a show of hands? Which we know does not work all the time. Okay. I even get letters from men who say, well, I've given up sex until I can find somebody who really turns me on because I'm afraid of AIDS, and my ideal partner is a 4 foot tall, purple skinned man from Venus who has 3 penises. Okay? I mean, it's like people are actually willing sometimes to give up sex rather than change their sexual practice. So, I mean, logically, doesn't that mean that what we should do is just get rid of all the porn that shows people exchanging body fluids, you know, blood, semen, vaginal secretions, all that stuff? You know, I mean, wouldn't that help? And shouldn't we censor even all of the personal ads of people who are soliciting those activities? You know, and there are some gay papers who have done that with the best of intentions. Much evil has been done in human history with the best of intentions. And after all, you know, logically, many of us supported closing the bathhouses. Now, I think that is an act that history will teach us to be ashamed of, but who am I to argue with all of the reforms or reforms? The problem with censorship is that it does not work. What it does is it leaves a gap in the discourse, and it makes people feel that the thing that is most important in their lives, maybe the only thing that gives them pleasure, is forbidden and is hateful. And when people have the decreased self-esteem and a decrease in that sense of camaraderie, when they feel more isolated, they become even less able to change their sexuality and even less likely to get the information about what changes they should make if they want to stay healthy. I don't think that educators have acknowledged often enough just how hard it is to change those patterns. Most of us have one, maybe two ways that we know we can get off. And if you change that, what you're risking is you're risking that you won't come. Okay? Now, the most frequent letters I get are from people who are saying, I can't meet anybody, I can't find partners, I can't connect. And in a world where we still have that much trouble just connecting with each other, when you ask people to risk getting off, you're asking them to take a big gamble. And for a lot of gay people who don't have access to organizations, activities, a community, gay sex is their gay identity. Okay. And if you think it's hard to get gay men to use condoms, you should try to get dykes to use demo dangers. A glove is not such a big deal because it's not like my hand is going to lose its heart on it if I put it on. But you just try and get somebody to give up the way sex tastes. It's a big one. Magazines would take some of the obscene profits that they make and instead of diverting them to the mafia, use them to pay people to actually put in more nonfiction information about safe sex. And I think that you need nonfiction information because people ask questions, they need detailed information, and they need more detailed information than that goddamn little box of safe, possibly safe, and unsafe. That more and more gay erotic writers are writing some safe sex porn. Okay? I've written some myself, sometimes under duress because the editor said, we're not publishing anything that has filth and slime going back and forth from orifice to orifice. Or the more refined version of that. And I remind myself as I started to do that, you know, that this is not the first generation of writers who had to deal with the fact that sex sometimes has fatal consequences. I mean, Boccaccio's The Decameron is set in the context of the play. And in fact, it's used as the reason why all of these ladies are sitting around telling these body stories. Because who cares? It's the end of the world. You have nothing to lose. You might as well make fun of the church and you know, tell witty stories about adultery. You know, in Victorian porn, you see writers employ a lot of devices to help readers suspend their anxiety about pregnancy and venereal disease. Now, today they look silly because we know they're not effective. You know, you have women douching after sex for birth control, and you have coitus interruptus, otherwise known as sticky skin. People ingesting mysterious herbs and wine that are supposed to, you know, keep them invulnerable from harm. Pregnant women just taking trips to Paris, you know, where everything is fixed, you know. Abortions and even occasional condoms, or as they will call them, French letters. Okay. And I do a lot of similar things. I employ all kinds of strategies in my writing to help me continue to do creative work and still cope with the fact that we have an epidemic, or actually an endemic disease that kills people. I write future sex. You know, I try to imagine what the impact of AIDS is going to be 100 years from now. I try to imagine worlds where it doesn't exist. But I still write porn about unsafe sex. And I also write porn that, and other fiction that includes drugs. And I want to talk about that a little bit. I'm a lesbian, and in the lesbian community, IV drug use is still the major vector for transmission of AIDS. And we never talk about it. You know, we never talk about it, and yet a lot of us are shooting up to get high. Okay? And we continue to kill ourselves, and we continue to kill our partners, because it's a secret and it's stigmatized and we don't talk about it. Now, I support 12-step programs. I support people getting clean and sober. But just saying everybody should go get clean and sober is like Nancy Reagan saying, just say no. Okay? It doesn't work. It doesn't stop people from getting high. So that even if you don't believe that there is such a thing as recreational drug use, you still have to be prepared to tell people how to get high without getting sick, because a dead junkie never got into treatment. And I have as much trouble getting gay men and lesbians to deal with IV drug use in our community as any of us have had getting straight doctors and straight politicians to deal with this disease. And we have our own epidemic of ignorance and shame about this that we have got to cope with. Most of the people I know who got sick from AIDS during the glory days of the 70s and the 80s can't really honestly tell me if they got sex from sex or from shooting up. Okay? Now, like most writers, I'm usually in an adversarial relationship with publishers. So, as much as it hurts me, I have to say that they have rights too. They have a right to publish material that they think won't sell or that they find morally offensive. But I do want to encourage publishers and editors to keep an open mind about graphic sexual material that does not consist solely of frontage, mutual J.O., and the mandatory donning of rubber underwear. Writing is what I do to stay alive. And I don't want someone else messing with the really delicate balance that I have to maintain in order to be able to do my work. When I write about unsafe sex, what I'm trying to do is salvage the love and the veneration that I have for the human body. And this is an experience that was really hard won. I mean, I don't even know if you remember the very first time you put your nose down there. But it was scary. I mean, everything you had, no one had ever told you you should or could or ought to do that. Nobody. I mean, you are alone before you take that dive. Right? there's something there that welcomes you. I think that you never feel quite as alone ever again. Sexuality that I find fascinating would be like saying, well, you have to stop writing about men. You know, you have to stop writing about characters who are people of color. You have to stop writing about sex, period. Writing is really hard work, and in order to put up with the frustration, I need to be able to feel passionate about my topics. And I also need to pick my own subjects. And I think that what writers do who continue to write about safe and unsafe sex is that they give us all a little bit of encouragement and a little bit more fuel to run on while we're trying to live in really difficult times. Thank you all for being here.
Currently, he's writer in residence at the Asian Project in Portland, Maine. His many books include Fanny, The Queen in Provincetown, and The Master's Series. His essays have appeared in The Advocate, Corona, Christopher Street, Harper's Magazine. He recently edited a book called Personal Dispatches, Writers to Friend Days.
Presence of two words, both of which scare me a great deal when they're put in the context of writing and writers. The first one is responsibility, and the second one is literature. I can't say it better than Sarah Schulman did any comment about the responsibility of the artist in our society. The responsibility of the artist in society is to do some of our own work first. There, all the stuff. Whenever we start getting into the responsibilities, we start moving into weird forms of propaganda making and weird forms of mixing up the entire society, attempting to do good things with our arts as opposed to doing our art. One of the things I remember the most, one of the elements in the dynamics which have been society's response or lack of response to AIDS in the past decade now, was this movement that at a certain point that we all had a responsibility to show that AIDS was not a gay disease. Somehow, in order to make AIDS acceptable to the society, and how could even AIDS ever be acceptable, somehow we had to deny what people call the gay ownership of AIDS. Now, I personally don't want to own AIDS, if they wanted to have it back, they could. But in doing so, whenever we start to get into a political motivation for our work, and we as artists begin to whichever of us get involved in that process, what we lost was the reality that can never be denied, which is that AIDS is a gay disaster.
Yeah.
And to acknowledge the disaster to our beginning nurturing community was one of the things that we were doing with our art. And to take that focus away from us was a denial, I think, of our art. But what I want to talk more about is this idea of literature. I think Sarah has been one of the most important people talking about truly the literary aspects of this disease. And I hope that the whole idea of having to have to examine our vocabulary, examine our approach and so forth, is really vital and important. One of the things that I think we need to talk about, though, or be aware of, is what is this thing called literature? And what kind of hold and sway it has upon us? The reality is that literature is simply a temporary agreement on the canons of writing. made between self-affirming authorities. That's all literature is. Now, there was a wonderful quote by, of all people, John Updike recently. In the New Yorker, and he was going after a bunch of people who are grouped together as the minimalists and take themselves very seriously as creators of literature. And Updike said, the modern writer, aware that he and she does not have a wide reach, now hopes that the reach is high. Not unlike the pre-bagging two priests with his back to the congregation. I think when you worry too much about what is literature, that you're in danger of becoming that kind of figure. I think one of the reasons that we should really challenge any of the concepts of literature, though, whenever we're going to talk about age and how we're going to approach age with our writing, is the simple fact that the canons that now exist cannot deal with AIDS. The canons which exist about how to write a novel, what is a good short story, what is melodramatic, what is artistic or not, fail in the face of the realities of AIDS. The stories, the everyday stories of our lives, will take the time to hear them among our people, as they're sick, are simply too overwhelming. They become, one after another, examples, if you're holding to the canon, of clunky melodrama that simply can't be dealt with by a critic or a criticism. One of my best friends, and one of the first friends I knew who had AIDS, raised dogs. And all of his dogs came from one bitch. As he got AIDS, he happened to have been a very vain and very handsome man. His body was ravaged constantly. He used all kinds of ways to deny what was going on with him. Even as he became emaciated, his face was covered with sores, and what were once by the normal thoughts of what is male beauty, a very handsome face, became incredibly distorted. But no one would talk to him about dying. No one would talk to him about what was happening to him. And he was left with a constant search for some kind of miraculous cure or healing, and he had no concept of the difference between cure and healing. One day, after he was in the hospital, and his chaos had spread tremendously, he was brought home, and a whole group of people were with him saying, "Oh, this is nothing, we're going through another incident," and so forth and so on. Treating AIDS, though, were a common cold. And what happened was that the dog came running to greet him as soon as she heard him come through the door. And she stopped short in the middle of the room and fell back onto her paws and whining, backed herself on the floor out of the room at the very sight of him. I would suggest to you that if any of us wrote that anecdote in a novel, we would never get it past a first reading. It would be deemed irresponsibly melodramatic and impossible. But those anecdotes and those stories are constant in the writing of AIDS. One of the things that's happened to me about writing and about because of AIDS and the whole AIDS experience, my language fails me again, has been understanding much more what is the power of writing. I think, quite frankly, that all we can do right now is get it all down. And I think what we need to do is get it all down and maybe not worry about things like literature and the rest of it. I was granted a grant from the Maine Arts Commission to become the writer in residence of the AIDS Project in Portland, Maine. And the clear expectation of the Maine Arts Commission was that there must be great art coming out of AIDS, and there must be literature. And some romantic notion exists that suffering produces art. I think that if you examine how much of the American literary establishment approaches art, that kind of thing is in our approach. And I started to work with people at the project on their writing, waiting for the great poet to evolve, waiting for the baby novelist to present himself or herself. And what I got instead was a series of lessons on how totally disenfranchised the general population of this country is from the word and from the power of the word, and how much we've made writing into some form of career and vocation that only some of us who are appropriately educated or gifted are supposed to have access to. I discovered that people who were desperately enraged felt no ability to write a letter to the newspaper. I found people who were terrified of their mortality, thinking they had no right to leave some piece of themselves to others. I also found a desperate need and appreciation of having some access to writing for the future. That there is something about writing. I was on a panel in Miami a few months ago with Edmund White and Holland, both of whom made this point over and over again. There is something about writing which grants some element of immortality, not so much to the writer, but to whomever the writer is writing about. And they talk about how they put the names of various people they know in as many essays and articles as possible to grant that immortality to them. This is an incredibly primal need to leave the written record. This is the power of the word. How do we handle that, and how do we handle the enormity of AIDS? I'm not always sure. I'd like to tell you, to close, one of the most important lessons that I had as a writer in residence of the project that sort of blew me away and brought many of these lessons into our being. A man approached the AIDS project and wanted to help, one had help writing letters to leave to his son. And he wanted a letter to the son for his confirmation, a letter to his son on graduation from high school, a letter to his son on his choice for career, and so forth. This is heartbreaking. This was one of the most horrible and beautiful things that I could imagine happening with writing. But all of these things are too immense sometimes. I don't know how we're ever to get a handle on how to tell these stories. Because I can go on and I can tell you all these things this man wanted. The overwhelming reality was that he was 19. And that is melodramatic, and I'm pulling your strings, and I have little tears in my eyes. And I'm